Welcome back, linguists. It's good of you to come along with me as we go linguisting once again. This time, I want to talk about constructed languages, or conlangs. So, what is a conlang? Well, a conlang is any language that is not natural. It is a language that some person has created. So, rather than it arising over the course of history like natural languages do, somebody sat down one day and just decided to make a language. And that's how conlangs work. The earliest evidence we have for a conlang dates to about 1200, when we find that the nun Hildegard von Bingen created the language Lingua Ignota. We're not quite sure what she was saying in her language because she didn't provide any translations, but we know that it wasn't a language that occurred naturally. We know that it was a conlang. She invented this language. And in fact, Lingua Ignota in Latin means unknown language. So this is the first evidence we have of a conlang. Conlangs, I think, are exciting, and the reason that they're one of the things that I study is because they're one of the few linguistic artifacts that we have besides writing. So that is, they're one of the few things that requires a linguistic understanding and yet is something that is made by a human being. So one question people often ask when I tell them that I do research on conlangs is, why bother? Why should we worry about invented languages when there are plenty of natural human languages that are disappearing? Well, there are a couple of reasons behind that. The first is that conlanging allows us to explore the limits of human language. So we can use conlangs as kind of psychological or test model languages to figure out what it is exactly that human languages have to do in order to be learnable, what kinds of things it just appears that all human languages do as maybe some kind of accident of history, and what really the brain needs us to do in a language in order to use it. But then also, I think that they're important just as linguistic artifacts. Most fields have some kind of artifactual element to them. If you're a chemist, you can do chemistry experiments, right? You can make the exploding volcano. If you're studying English literature, you can write. If you're studying economics, you can create certain games and certain tests and models that people can use in order to not only test your theories, but also in order to explain your theories at a very basic level. Aside from writing, which is itself artifactual, linguistics doesn't really have any of these activity book type things. And I think that conlanging allows us to begin to get at that level. It allows us to see language as an object that we can manipulate. And the first part of getting to understand language from an objective viewpoint is viewing it as an object that you can manipulate, which is why I think that conlanging is very important. So at the very most basic level, you have what are called codes or naming languages. These are aspects of conlangs, but they're not fully developed. So if you create a new orthography, a new way of writing an already existing language, like a new way of writing English, for example, that is a kind of code, and so that's within the realm of conlanging, but it's not yet a full lang. Other examples include Lapine, the language of the rabbits from Watership Down, the bits of future language that you find in Dune, in the Dune series, the kind of quasi-Greek Latin in Harry Potter, for the magical spells in Harry Potter. In fact, most of the bits of language that you see in the movies are codes and naming languages. They're not fully developed. So if you watch a movie like Quest for Fire, the language that they developed for the cavemen is only a code. It's not a full language. So then on the other extreme of things, you have full languages, things like Klingon and Dothraki, things like Sindarin or Laodan. These are things that are fully developed. You could, if you had the right community of speakers, go out and use them as full languages. These aren't just artistic languages, though. A lot of the auxiliary languages are also fully developed conlangs. Things like Esperanto and its offshoots like Edo and Novial. These are all fully developed languages. Finally, we can talk about underdeveloped conlangs. Things that have the potential to become full langs, but we don't yet have enough pieces of information in order to know what their full lang would look like. So something like Sol Re Sol, where all of the mechanics are there, but we just don't have enough words yet to figure out what that language would look like. Or for Tolkien, the things like Cuzdul or Entish, where we know that there are parts, and had Tolkien wanted to, we know that he could have developed them because he was a fantastic linguist, but he just didn't. Or again, if you watch a movie like Clan of the Cave Bear, the language that the Neanderthals are speaking in that, which is this language that combines spoken and sign languages, it could be developed into a full language, but there isn't enough material yet. roughly speaking, we can say that there are four different kinds of conlangs. So the first category of conlangs are called auxiliary languages, or auxlangs. These are languages that are created to kind of exist alongside the world's natural languages. Languages that are created so that the world can have a single language that everyone can speak that isn't tied to the natural histories of national languages. So German has a particular history to it that goes along with the history of Germany and the history of German speakers. And that might not be good for everybody to therefore adopt German. But if we create a language, if we make something that isn't related to any natural history, then we can have a language that everybody can speak and is kind of neutral that way. Famous examples of auxlangs include Esperanto, created by Ludwig Zamenhof in 1887, or Sol Re Sol, the musical language, created by François Sudre in 1827.
Then, when spread out.
The next category we can talk about are philosophical languages. These are languages that are developed and created with the specific goal of testing some kind of philosophical problem. So one of the most famous philosophical languages is called Loglan, and it was invented in order to test the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, the idea that the language that we speak affects how we think about the world. You can also think of computer languages as kinds of philosophical languages. So things like BASIC or Python, they're invented as a way of categorizing the world, and therefore we can think of them as offshoots, at the very least, of philosophical languages. The next category to think about is the category you're probably the most familiar with. These are called artistic languages, or art langs. These are languages that are created just for the goal of creating a language. Just because you want to create a language, that's what an art lang is. Examples that you might be familiar with include Klingon from the Star Trek franchise, Dothraki from Game of Thrones, Quenya and Sindarin from J.R.R. Tolkien's books, or Laodan from Suzette Hayden Elgin's Native Tongue trilogy. Most of the languages that you know of that are conlangs, most of the time people talk about conlangs, they're talking about artlangs. And then finally, the fourth category is kind of an overarching category that can encompass the other three. And these are what are called personal languages. They're languages that people invent just so they can have a language that is their own. They're not intended for public consumption. So Lingua Ignota was certainly a personal language. Hildegard von Bingen never anticipated that the world would discover her language and try and find out what she was saying. So thanks for sticking around. Thanks for watching this episode. So now how about this? How about you go out and with the knowledge that you have from linguistics, you go linguisting on your own by creating a new language. See what you can come up with. See you next time.